No, I'm weird about that. Conference committee will come to order. If everybody could take their seats. Morning, everyone, and welcome. I want to thank Senator Murray and the entire committee for all their work so far. Since our last meeting, Patty and I have been talking. We're discussing the parameters of a potential agreement. We're trying to find common ground, but we're not there yet. There's a big gap between our two budgets, if anyone noticed, and that's why we're talking. We hope that today's meeting will keep the ball rolling. As I said the last time, the reason we are here is to get an agreement. We've spent a lot of time talking about our differences. We've got that part down cold. That's the easy part. The hard part is figuring out where we agree. Here is how this is going to work today. I'm not going to start with an opening statement. We are here to hear from our CBO director, Dr. Elmendorf. Dr. Elmendorf is going to give us a brief on the budget, on the economic outlook, and on the long-term economic budget outlook. Then we'll open it up for discussion. I'll recognize any member for up to 2 minutes for a discussion or to ask a question of the CBO director. The director's answers will not come out of that person's two-minute allotment. People can be recognized more than once if they choose to do so, and we intend to adjourn at noon. With that, I'd like to recognize Senator Murray for any comments that she may have before we recognize Dr. Elmendorf.
Well, thank you very much, Chairman Ryan, and thank you to Dr. Elmendorf for being here today and all of our committee members who are here to participate today. I think we all recognize that our nation is facing some very serious economic challenges. Our economy is recovering, but far too slowly, and our highest priority has to be making sure that we meet our short and medium-term needs to create jobs and boost the economy. And as Dr. Elmendorf will talk to us about today, we face some serious long-term fiscal challenges as well that we've got to work together on. I think Chairman Ryan and I both know this is not easy. Our budgets are dramatically different, but it is extremely important, and we agree that we need to step out of our partisan corners and make some compromises and lay down a foundation for some long-term bipartisan agreements. We have been, as he said, had a number of discussions since our last meeting regarding the parameters of a potential deal, and I've been very encouraged by those conversations. They are going to continue in the days ahead, and I'm hopeful that we will get to a bipartisan compromise very soon. So I, too, look forward to this productive discussion today to help us reach that goal, and I thank everybody for being here.
Thank you. Dr. Elmendorf, floor is yours.
Thank you very much. My colleagues and I are very happy to be here. I will briefly review the economic and budget outlook, and then we'll try to answer any questions that you have. I'll be referring to the charts that are in front of you for people in the room, and those charts have just been posted on CBO's website for people who are watching from afar. In February, we projected that economic growth would be slow this year, and that a more rapid expansion would begin next year. That is still our view. In particular, real GDP is on track to rise about 2% this year, a little above the 1.5% that we had envisioned, but still only a modest increase. The unemployment rate, shown in your first chart, the bottom of the front page, has come down more than we had expected, but employment has not grown more than we expected. Instead, there's been a further decline in the number of people in the labor force. As a result, the share of the population with jobs, shown in the chart on the top of the next page, is very close to what it was 4 years ago. This ratio is trending down gradually because of the retirement of the baby boomers and other demographic factors, but it has fallen well below its trend. We estimate that employment is now about 5 million jobs short of what it would be if the unemployment rate were back down to its sustainable level and participation in the labor force was back up to its trend. The primary cause of the distress in the labor market is a shortfall in the demand for goods and services relative to the productive capacity of the economy, and therefore in the demand for workers. The primary reason why demand is weak is the lingering effects of the housing bubble and financial crisis. But fiscal policy has mattered too. The positive short-term economic impact of the spending increases and tax cuts in the 2009 Recovery Act has been fading for 3 years. Other stimulative measures have expired, and the Congress has enacted additional legislation to reduce budget deficits in the near term. The combined effect of the deliberate policy choices you have made and automatic stabilizers in the budget has been to reduce the deficit from about 10% of GDP in 2009 to about 4% in 2013. That is the most abrupt fiscal tightening since the end of the Second World War. And though that tightening has had the beneficial effect of slowing the accumulation of government debt, our analysis indicates that it has also slowed economic growth during the past few years. Moreover, uncertainty about fiscal policy has been unusually high, owing to the surge in debt and stark disagreements about tax and spending policies. Disagreements that have led repeatedly to delayed enactment of appropriation bills, worries about defaults on federal debt, and showdowns over other budget issues. That uncertainty is also probably dampening growth, although we do not know by how much. The further tightening of fiscal policy built into current law for the next few years, as well as ongoing uncertainty about fiscal policy, represent continued headwinds to the economic recovery. At this point, we think that 2014 will see an upswing in housing construction, rising real estate and stock prices, and increasing availability of credit, as well as a reduction in fiscal drag relative to 2013, given current law. In our judgment, all of that will help to spur a virtuous circle of faster growth in employment, income, consumer spending, and business investment. However, everyone should be cautious about that outlook. Researchers who have studied the historical record of housing bubbles and financial crises have been warning since 2007 that working off an excessive housing stock, improving balance sheets, restoring credit, and regaining confidence generally takes time. We think the economy will turn the corner next year, but no one can be sure. In addition to the near-term economic challenges, the country faces significant long-term economic and budgetary challenges. For one thing, the prolonged weakness in the economy has lowered its productive capacity for years to come. Persistent long-term unemployment, shown in your next chart, will lead some workers to leave the workforce earlier than they would have otherwise, and will erode the skills of other workers. In addition, lower capital investment and productivity growth will reduce future output and income. Moreover, as you know, the aging of the population, the expansion of federal subsidies for health insurance, and rising health care costs will put increasing pressure on the federal budget. If you flip to the next page at the top, your next chart shows our projection of budget deficits for the coming decade under current law. Although deficits will fall to about 2% of GDP by 2015, they will then begin to increase again, reaching 3.5% of GDP, or nearly $1 trillion by 2023. Moreover, under the extended baseline in our long-term budget outlook, deficits continue to increase beyond the coming decade. As a result, federal debt held by the public, shown in the chart at the bottom of that page, would reach 100% of GDP 25 years from now, even without accounting for the harmful economic effects of that increase in debt. There are at least three reasons why we and other analysts are concerned about the long-term budget outlook. First, debt is already larger relative to the size of the economy than at any point in our history, except for a brief period around World War II. Even if debt remains near its current 73% of GDP, future wages and incomes will be lower than they would be with less debt. Also, the government's interest costs will rise dramatically when interest rates return to more normal levels. Your ability to use fiscal policy to respond to future financial crises, recessions, and international threats will be much more constrained. And the risk of a fiscal crisis, will be higher than it would be with less debt. All of those problems of keeping debt at its current share of GDP will be worse if debt rises significantly and persistently relative to the size of the economy. Second, we project that under current law, debt will rise significantly and persistently relative to the size of the economy. Projections, and especially long-term projections, are very uncertain. But our long-term outlook showed that the federal budget is on an unsustainable path under a wide range of possible assumptions about some key factors that influence federal spending and revenues. You know the main reasons. The retirement of the baby boomers and the rising costs of health care are pushing up the costs of the largest federal programs. Your next chart, top of the next page, shows federal spending and revenues under CBO's baseline compared with past averages. So for example, in the top left corner of the chart, you can see that Social Security outlays represented 4.2% of GDP on average between 1973 and 2012, the last 40 years. We're 4.9% of GDP last year, and will be 5.3% of GDP we project in 2023. If you take spending for Social Security and Medicare together, that was about 6% of GDP on average over the past 40 years. But it will be more than 8.5% of GDP by 2023, and in our long-term outlook, we show that by 2038, it will be more than 11% of GDP. Meanwhile, defense spending, shown in the third bank of the numbers, is on track to be a shrinking share of GDP. And all other non-interest spending taken together, everything but Social Security and Medicare and defense, will be roughly the same share of GDP in 2023 that it was on average during the past 40 years and that it is today. I want to make it clear that the steadiness of this GDP share of the all other category masks some very different patterns among its subcomponents. As you can see in the chart at the bottom of the page, in this other category, means-tested healthcare programs are taking a growing share of GDP, owing to the expansion of insurance coverage through the Affordable Care Act and rising healthcare costs per person. In contrast, non-defense discretionary spending is on track to be a sharply shrinking share of GDP, owing in part to the caps from the Budget Control Act. We show figures like these not to suggest that you should try to repeat the budget configurations of the past, but instead to help you and others understand which parts of the federal budget are expanding relative to the size of the economy and which are shrinking. There's no particular reason that outlays for Social Security and Medicare need to be cut back to their historical average share of GDP when a larger fraction of the population is old enough to receive benefits from those programs. However, if those programs are not cut back, then we will need to collect a larger share of GDP in tax revenue relative to our history, or cut back on other federal benefits and services relative to what we have been accustomed to. The third reason for concern about the long-term budget outlook is that current laws underlying our baseline projections include provisions that would restrain deficits in significant ways, but might raise widespread objections as they took full effect. I'll offer two examples, both of which can be seen in the charts I just discussed. First, given the structure of the tax code, revenues would rise above their historical average share of GDP in just a few years and would keep rising, reaching more than 2 percentage points above that historical average by 2038. At the same time, outlays for defense and non-defense discretionary programs would be smaller relative to the size of the economy in 2017 and beyond than at any point in at least 50 years. Indeed, discretionary funding for the next decade under the current caps would be about $1.5 trillion less what would be needed to provide the benefits and services that were provided in 2013. To be sure, depending on one's goals and priorities, there may not be anything wrong with either of those developments. My point is simply that if either of those current law policies is not maintained, either the increase in tax receipts or the sharp drop in discretionary spending, if those are not maintained and other changes to spending and revenues are not made, then deficits will be greater, maybe a lot greater, than we're projecting under current law. To sum up, we face both short-term and long-term economic challenges. And those challenges are related to fiscal policy in different ways. The long-term challenge can be addressed in part by reducing future deficits, whereas the short-term challenge has been exacerbated by the recent sharp reduction in deficits. Policy changes that led to less fiscal tightening in the near term but greater tightening in later years would improve the economic outlook for both time horizons relative to our current projections. To help you and other members of Congress make informed decisions about possible policy changes, we have just completed our biennial volume of specific options for reducing the deficit. We brought a copy for each of you, and we'll be posting the report on our website at noon today. I want to close on a note of optimism. When I make presentations like this, I worry that my toting up all the economic and budget challenges our country faces can make the problem seem so large that it actually discourages people from tackling them. That would be unfortunate. Of course, a clear resolution of the long-term budgetary concerns would be beneficial. But even if that is not feasible right now, reallocating elements of the budget to comport better with the country's priorities as you view them, while reducing uncertainty about fiscal policy next year and improving, or at least not worsening, the long-run budget outlook, would be a good thing for the economy and for our fellow citizens, even if it left significant challenges to be addressed in next year's budget process. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Instead of making this more of a formal hearing type procedure, I think we'll make it a little more of an informal discussion. I'll just ask members to put your placards up, right side up. If you want to get in the queue to speak, we'll alternate between Republicans and Democrats. As I mentioned, just so we can keep the flow going and respect everyone's time, we'll limit members' comments or questions for the director to 2 minutes, not including his time, and members can speak more than once, of course. So I see Mr. Portman. I'll go with Mr. Portman, and then Mr. Whitehouse in the queue after him.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Director Elmendorf, thank you for your insights this morning, and as you said at the end, you have kind of depressing information for us, which is that things don't look good and they could be even worse unless we continue to see these relatively high rates of revenue, as you said, over the coming decades, and continue to see these relatively low rates of domestic discretionary spending. I have two questions for you quickly. One is with regard to tax revenues, one is with regard to interest rates. You did not mention interest rates, and it seems to me if we go back to an historical level on interest rates, we also have a huge problem in terms of meeting these projections that you lay out. Specifically, I think a point in interest rates, about $120 billion a year increase in deficit. So if you could give us an answer on that, what do you consider to be the historic rate, if we went back to that historic rate of interest, and we already see a creeping up of the rate today, what would be the impact on the deficit? And second, with regard to taxes, you mentioned that we are, reading from what you said, that tax revenues are going to be above the historic levels. You say by 2038, 2 points above the historic level. What will be, over the next decade, the average tax as a percent of GDP? I think that figure is 18.9%, as I look at your material you gave us. And how does that compare to other decades? My sense is that other than between 1993 and 02, we've never had a 10-year period with revenue at that level. If that's accurate, I'd like to hear it. If it's not, I'd like to hear it. And then second, what will be like in the next decade, or if you can give us the next 2 decades, understanding that, as you say, there's more uncertainty as you go further out. So two questions, one on interest rates, what the impact on the deficit is, and second, where are we in terms of taxes as a percent of the economy, and how does it compare to past decades?
So, Senator, we expect that interest rates will remain fairly low for another few years because the economy will be, although recovering, will still have significant unused resources and low inflation, and we think that will keep the Federal Reserve in a fairly easy posture for monetary policy and will keep private credit demands low. So we think rates will stay low for a few years, but then we think they will return toward more normal levels. We project that short-term interest rates, rates on three-month Treasury bills, will rise to 4% by 2018 or so, and we think that 10-year Treasury note rates will be a little over 5%, 5.25% at that point. And that normalization of interest rates has a profound effect on the interest burden. So nominal interest payments by the federal government last year, net interest was a couple hundred billion dollars, and we project in 2023 it'll be about $800 billion, from about a little over $200
billion.
$800 billion
in interest payments alone.
In 2023 alone, yep. As a share of GDP, interest payments will rise from less than 1.5% of GDP to more than 3% of GDP over those 10 years.
And there can be different projections on whether that's a conservative estimate or not of 4% for short-term rates, but you're talking about almost $1 trillion.
It's a lot of money, Senator.
Interest alone.
Your question about tax revenue, as you know, the Bureau of Economic Analysis revised historical GDP data this summer, and we've incorporated that into our projections as a share of GDP. So the number that I have in front of me is that tax revenue will average 18.3% of GDP over the coming decade. That's just taking the larger level of GDP that the BEA has built into history and projecting it, taking the same projection of dollar revenues that we had from May. So we get 18.3% now. That compares with an average historically, as I said, of 17.4%. And if we look further out by 2038, under current law, we think that fraction will be up to 19.7%.
And have we ever had a, given the apples-to-apples comparison of the new GDP estimate, have we ever had 18.3% for any decade in our history?
No, I don't think so, Senator.
So we are at historically high rates of taxation as a percent of the economy for the next decade, and then, as you say, continuing to increase after that.
Yes, taxes are moving well above what they've been historically under current law.
Yeah, I think you'll find from 93 to 02 we had similar rates, perhaps close, but that was in part due to a bubble, as we all know now, and it also did not continue at that sustained rate, and this projection is to continue at the highest sustained rates in our history. Thank you.
Thanks, Rob. Mr. Whitehouse.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Elmendorf, welcome.
Thank you, Senator. I
think we come into this discussion with spending cuts that we've already accomplished of $1.5 trillion, adding to $1.75 trillion, counting associated interest savings, with tax rate increases increasing revenues by $600 billion, count that $700 billion with associated interest savings, roughly, and with tax deductions, loophole closing, et cetera, of $0, nothing yet. And I'd like to put up a slide, if I could, that shows the ratio between, it's over here, shows the ratio between what we collect through our tax system and what goes out the back door through deductions and loopholes. And you'll see that in the green and blue, for every dollar that we actually collect through the tax code, 90 cents goes out the back door for individual taxes. And for every dollar that we actually collect through the corporate tax code, 60-some cents goes out the back door through deductions and loopholes. Now, Mr. Elmendorf, you said, CBO said in a report last year on choices for deficit reduction that expanding tax bases, which I think is CBO language for reducing that money going out the back door of the tax code, you're nodding yes, quote, would reduce the deficit and generally have a smaller negative effect or even a positive effect on how efficiently the economy operates. Now, smaller negative effect was in reference to reducing the deficit by raising tax rates. But you did mention not only a smaller negative effect, but also the chance of even a positive effect on the economy from reducing the tax spending and the loopholes. Could you explain that?
Yes, Senator. The different treatment of different sorts of consumption and different sorts of investment in the tax code, because of a whole slew of provisions that Congress has enacted over time, distorts the decisions that households and businesses make. And it, in some cases, those distortions to behavior may be an effort to correct some other distortion that exists in the world. Maybe there are reasons we think people don't do enough of something to achieve some social gain. But some of them distort behavior that would otherwise be efficient and becomes inefficient because of the greater tax subsidy or lower tax rate on certain sorts of activities. So to the extent that tax reform effort were to reduce some of the differences in the tax treatment of different household or business decisions, it could lead households and businesses to make more efficient decisions, and that would improve potentially GDP and improve people's well-being. It depends, of course, on the nature of the changes that are made. Not anything that is labeled tax reform would have those effects, but certainly tax reform could have those effects.
And just to be clear, the gains from tax loophole closing would go disproportionately, now go disproportionately to the highest income sectors of the economy, correct?
Yeah. I'm not trying to cut you off, but I just want to make sure that the 2 minutes are kind of the 2 minutes.
I was following Senator Portman's example.
Yeah, I know. I was going to call him then, too. So
we'd be treated alike.
Yeah, right. I will just say quickly that
we've
done an analysis of the distribution of tax expenditures. Certain ones are received very disproportionately by higher income people. Others are received disproportionately by lower-income people. The latter category would be something like the earned income tax credit. I encourage you to look at that report, and we're happy to send a copy for you all to look at.
Thank you. Let's go with Senator Sessions, then Mr. Clyburn.
Mr. Chairman, with regard to the tax loopholes, we do need to close those. We've got a far too complex system that's causing abuses to occur. The Finance Committee and the Senate, I know, is working on that very hard. They're trying to reform our system, and Senator Baucus and Senator Hatch have solicited ideas, and I hope we can make progress on that, and I would support it for sure. Looking at your chart, Mr. Elmendorf, on table 6-2, I think it helps explain why it's important that we constrain at least the growth in spending. We're not talking about long-term spending reductions. We're talking about containing or constraining the growth in spending. And you indicate on that chart that if we were to maintain or actually reduce spending over the next 10 years by $4 trillion, that we would achieve greater growth than would otherwise be the case. Indeed, your chart shows that by 2038, we'd have 7% more growth. But if we were to maintain our present course and not achieve $4 trillion in spending reductions, we would end up with a minus 7%. That's a very dramatic difference. And I'll just share this with you. The President's Office of Management and Budget, the Federal Reserve have missed the growth projections in the future. You might be closer this year, but in the past you've missed it quite significantly. And colleagues, I just saw the Barron's magazine had a cover story on slow growth. They project for the next 20 years growth would be 1.8% based on a number of research numbers. Mark Zandi, who's testified as a Democratic witness several times, projects 1.8% for the next 5 years. So, Mr. Elmendorf, this prescription suggests we could have better growth if we get serious about constraining our spending. Is that accurate?
So, Senator, so as you know, you're referring, I think, to Figure 6-2 from our long-term budget outlook, which looks at the longer-term effects of different paths for federal debt. We do not distinguish here between the effects of reducing spending or raising revenues. This is simply analysis of the effects of having narrower deficits. And you're absolutely right. Narrower deficits will be good for the economy in the longer term. As I've said earlier today and on many occasions, the deficit reduction that has occurred over the past few years has actually been a headwind on economic growth because the near-term economic problem is primarily a shortfall in the demand for goods and services. That's rather different from the medium and longer-term economic challenge, which is to boost the supply of the factors of production of labor and capital and technological progress.
Mr. Clyburn.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, on yesterday, the Wall Street Journal ran a front page story dealing with the widening job gap in our economy. And you may recall, Mr. Elmendorf, that during the so-called super committee, you and I had a little exchange about the impact of unemployment rates on our deficit. And there was a stark correlation between the two. Now, this report that we just saw on yesterday, if we look at the 30-year study that you reported to us, or that was released while we were having those discussions with the tax, the so-called super committee, it means that things have gotten even worse since then when it comes to unemployment rates and the impact that is having on our deficit. And I really would be interested in how you view this study, as well as there was a study, I think, at UC Berkeley, indicating that all of this the increase in wages, that 90% of those increases went to the upper 1%, and most of that to upper 0.1%. Now, I'm really, really interested in that, but I'm also interested in whether or not you will define spending as many others are beginning to define spending. A lot of people say, and I would not disagree, that we ought to look at just cutting spending. But the question is whether or not entitlement programs, if you call that spending, would you call tax expenditures tax entitlements? Because I have noticed that a lot of economists are now looking at what we call tax expenditures as tax entitlements, because this occurs time and time again and gets back to what Senator Whitehouse has said. I would really be interested in your views on the tax entitlements versus tax expenditures.
So, Congressman, to start, I'm not, I'm afraid, familiar with all the studies you mentioned, but it is certainly true that there is a great diversity of economic experience in this country, that all of the charts that I tend to show about the average unemployment rate or overall income growth are missing. The diversity lies underneath that. So, for example, if one looks at unemployment rates, although the overall unemployment rate in October was 7.3%, the unemployment rate for people between 20 and 24 years of age was 12.5%, much, much higher. The unemployment rate for people with less than a high school diploma was almost 11%. The unemployment rate for African Americans was a little over 13%. So there's a tremendous, and of course there are categories, groups of people for whom the unemployment rate was less than the national average. So there's a tremendous diversity of experience in how this recession has hurt people and the extent to which people's fortunes have improved or not during this recovery. There also are, as you mentioned, long-term trends in which a larger, over time, a growing share of the total national income is going to people at the higher end of the income distribution. And more particularly, people at many other points of the income distribution have experienced rather small gains in income over a period of many years. And we do ongoing analysis of that, and we are working right now to update our analysis that we released. The last one we released was last year. There'll be one shortly from us that will update the look at the distribution of the federal tax burden and the distribution of income in the country. On your point about tax expenditures, the term tax expenditures is an old term. It is in the Budget Act that established CBO almost 40 years ago. But I think there are a large number of analysts on both sides of the political spectrum and with a wide range of views about appropriate policy who think that from an analytic perspective, tax expenditures are best viewed as a form of government spending because they are direct actions by the federal government to give benefits to particular activities or particular groups of people, much like federal spending programs.
Thank you. Let's go with Senator Crapo and Senator Baldwin then.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Elmendorf, I kind of want to ask a two-part question like Senator Portman did. First of all, in 2009, when we had the $800 billion stimulus package before the Congress, I believe you were CBO director, you were just starting then.
Yes.
And CBO issued a report that is a common type of report that we see from economists who testify before us, which said that the stimulus package, which was entirely borrowed money, would in the short term have a stimulative effect, and that in the longer term, which if I recall correctly was 2 or 3 years, starting in 2 or 3 years, it would start to have a depressing effect on the economy because of the impact of the borrowing. Is that your recollection of that report?
So our analysis, Senator, and we actually still update this pursuant to federal law on a regular basis, is that the Recovery Act provided the biggest boost to the level of output and employment fairly soon after its enactment, and has provided a waning boost since then. We think that the extra debt will start to be an actual drag on the level of output later in this decade, not yet. So I think your qualitative point is right, but I wouldn't say a few years. It was
the
more
timing.
Toward the
so,
end of
so
the
my
decade.
Question is this, and the second aspect of it is, as we look at the fact that we are getting closer and closer to the drag of that stimulus spending and the debt that is growing, I think you've indicated we're on an unsustainable path. And as we look at the question of the tax expenditures that Senator Whitehouse pointed out that we need to look at, many of us have been fighting not to raise revenue because of the utilization of the tax increases, but to reform the tax code by flattening the base and reducing the rates. I believe that you have testified in the past that that would have a very positive stimulative effect on the economy if we approached the reform of the tax code in that fashion. Would that be true?
I think it would have a stimulative effect. The size of the stimulative effect depends on the nature of the tax reform itself. But
right,
I think it certainly can be a very positive factor, Senator. I just want to be careful about attaching particular adjectives to just a general notion of tax reforms. As you understand, lots of things could be labeled that, and it really does depend on the extent to which you and your colleagues are willing to do the base broadening measures, remove the tax expenditures in order to bring down the tax rates.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Baldwin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the chart you have on the second page, short-term versus long-term unemployment rates. The Federal Reserve recently released a paper that stated that long-term unemployment or long-term unemployed people become less and less attached to the workforce, obviously, lose skills that they once had, and as their productive capacity diminishes, it also diminishes the growth capacity for our overall economy. The paper concluded that what should be a cyclical downturn in employment has the potential to become structural. And I guess I just want to hear you dig down a little bit deeper on this topic, because when I look at that chart, this is an alarming figure. In terms, if it were the top priority of this conference committee to dig into that problem, what are our key fiscal policy options to prevent this from moving from a cyclical problem into a structural problem?
So, Senator, we do think that the weakness in the economy over the past 5 years has reduced the productive capacity for the rest of the coming decade. And what we've said so far is that we've reduced our projected level of potential output for the end of the decade by 1.5% because of the downturn, and that's partly through workers leaving the labor force or losing skills. It's partly through reduced capital investment, partly through lower productivity. But we are carefully reevaluating those estimates now as beginning our process of doing the next year's economic and budget projections. And we may conclude that these effects are larger than we had expected. And I think you're absolutely right that the persistently high level of long-term unemployment is a very worrisome factor for the economy. We wrote a report a year or two ago now about policies that could be used to bring down unemployment. I think some of those are on the macroeconomic side. Basically, that amounts to stimulating the demand for firms' products so that firms need to hire workers in order to meet that demand. And that can be done partly through monetary policy, which I'm not here to talk about, but also can be done through fiscal policy. And the primary way to stimulate economic activity in the short run is to lower taxes or raise spending now. However, to be clear, there's a consequence of doing that without taking other steps to pay off that debt later, and that's the point that Senator Crapo was making about what happens over the medium term and long term. There are also some economists would call microeconomic policies that try to help improve the workings of labor markets or improve the skills of workers by strengthening their training or by improving their ability to find jobs for which they have the right training. And our report detailed a number of things that can be done. I don't think any of them should be viewed as silver bullets. They're mostly ideas that have been tried and worked or not worked so well on a rather small scale. But we would be happy to sit down with you and talk more about that set of options.
Just as a closing comment on this, I was talking about unemployment, short-term versus long, but if you look at the jobs report, we have a greatly diminished manufacturing and construction sector, and what added employment we have seen has been increasingly in lower wage sectors like leisure and hospitality and retail, which also relates to the productive capacity of our nation. So.
Yes, I think that's right. It is importantly a matter of people finding jobs, but also a matter of their finding jobs that use their talents in ways that contribute to the economy and also allow them to receive higher pay.
Thank you. Let's go with Dr. Price and Senator Sanders.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to commend you and Senator Murray for continuing to provide opportunities for exchange of ideas and gaining information. Dr. Elmendorf, welcome back once again. I was struck by your three conclusions. One, debt larger than any time in our history except for a short time after World War II. Two, debt will continue to rise and that we are on, your words, an unsustainable path. And three, that current law, if followed, will result in a decrease of Congress's ability, the people's representatives' ability, to provide prioritization in spending on defense and non-defense areas to a smaller level than any time in the last 50 years in 2017 and beyond. So real fundamental change in the work that Congress does. Now, I'm hopeful that that we can reach a large agreement, and I think we can reach an agreement. I'm not sure how large it's going to be, but I'm hopeful that it is large, but I think we need to walk before we can run, likely. And so my question is a specific question about sequester. The discretionary side of spending will decrease January 15th down to 965, 967 or so. There are many who believe that that's not appropriate either on the defense side or on the social side and that we ought to mitigate that. I've been intrigued by some who have come to me and said that a way to mitigate that, a possibility for mitigating that, is to accelerate the contributions that states make to the expansion of the Medicaid program that was contained in the ACA. As you know, for the first 3 years, it's 100% federal subsidy. Is that one option that might be able to allow us to mitigate the problem, the challenge of sequester, and also potentially decrease federal spending?
Well, Congressman, that is one way to reduce federal spending, is to have states bear a larger portion of the Medicaid costs. And if you were to do that and simultaneously raise the caps on discretionary spending, then you could, I think, accomplish the aim that you're suggesting. Yes. As you know, there's the point of the big book is there are an awful lot of ways to cut spending or raise revenue. In ways that you could use to reduce the debt relative to our projections or to offset some other element of the projections that you don't think are a good idea for the country.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You. Mr. Sanders.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Elmendorf, for being here. Dr. Elmendorf, I thought your presentation was very, very strong and interesting, except you, I think, kind of left out some very important facts of contemporary America, and I'm going to tell you what I think, and you tell me if you agree or if I'm wrong. One of the difficult jobs that this committee has is not only trying to come up with a budget, which is hard, but also within the budget deal with priorities. You know, when you spend money, when you cut money, it impacts real human beings. Now, my impression is that in America today, we have the most unequal distribution of wealth and income since the late 1920s, that in fact, in terms of financial wealth, the top 1% owns about 38% of the wealth of America, while the bottom 60% owns all of 2.3%. And my understanding also is top 1% today in terms of income earns more income than the bottom 50%. And between 2009 and 2012, 95% of all new income went to the top 1%. Does that sound roughly right?
So, Senator, it sounds roughly right. We have not done analysis ourselves through 2012 nor back to the 1920s, and I'm not an expert on that other work. But you are certainly right that the distribution of income and wealth in this country is much more uneven now than it has been in decades.
All right, and I say that because as we go forward in terms of our priority, and some folks want to cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid and programs for low-income people, We also have to recognize, correct me if I'm wrong here, that we have more people living in poverty today than any time in American history, 46.5 million people. Is that right?
Well, as you know, Senator, the calculation of poverty rates is a complicated business. The standard series, as you know, actually excludes many of the benefits that the federal government provides to low-income people. So I'm just not familiar with what the...
Let me ask you this also, and I think this is an important point. Again, it's important to understand the past as we go forward. Your chart that you gave us tells us that up until 2001, I think 98, 99, 2000, 2001, we actually had a surplus. We had a surplus. Now, is it fair to say that the reason we began to go into deficit was because we went to war in Iraq, which by the time we take care of the last veteran is going to cost us about $3 trillion? How do we pay for that war?
So, Senator, as you know, Congress cut taxes and then spent significant...
You mean in the middle of a war, you're not suggesting that in the middle of a war which costs $3 trillion, Congress actually cut taxes for the rich? You're not suggesting that, are you?
Bernie, we're...
Senator, as you... The Congress cut taxes for a lot of people, and the Congress spent a lot of money fighting overseas.
Point being, the reason we're in a deficit today is two unpaid wars, a Medicare Part D program unpaid for, large tax breaks, $1 trillion of which went to the wealthy. And I only say that is that as we go forward to figure out where we want to be as priorities, you got to remember that fact as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You got it. So let's go with Senator Johnson.
Mr. Chairman, may I just...
Go ahead, Doug.
My only response to you, Senator, would be to note that we released a study earlier this week of the distribution of federal spending and taxes. This is for 2006, which were the latest full set of data that we could collect. But it goes through in great detail the ways in which different federal programs, cash transfers and other sorts of transfers, and also federal revenues, how they affect people, households in different categories and households at different income levels. And if you were, those of you who are particularly concerned about the distributional impact of change that you were considering, we hope this information will be very helpful to you. It predates the recession.
It is a very helpful body of work. I encourage members to read it.
Overall picture.
Let's go with Senator Johnson and Congresswoman Lowy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Elmendorf, I'm looking at your last chart here where you're showing the dramatic increase in means-tested health care programs. So I'd like to ask a kind of a multi-part question on the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act. Certainly when I learned the details of the act, in no way, shape, or form did I think that every American would be able to hold on to their health care plan. I knew millions of Americans would lose their health care plan, which is why in our budget process here in the Senate, we passed an amendment on a bipartisan basis asking the CBO to actually score what would happen when 30, 50, and 100% of employees lose their employer-sponsored care, get put in the exchanges, and how much would that cost in terms of subsidies. So, three-part question. First of all, did you believe the president when he repeatedly said that if you like your health care plan, you can keep it? Two, has the CBO done any work to actually give Congress that estimate of how much Obamacare is really going to cost? And three, your current CBO estimate says over the next 10 years, Obamacare will cost $2.4 trillion. I think the estimate is there will be about $1 trillion of tax revenue associated with the plan. Where does the other $1.4 trillion come from?
So, Senator, on your first question, as you know, our initial analysis of the Affordable Care Act showed that, in our judgment, some people would lose and would not have employer-sponsored insurance who would have had it in the absence of the act. And we also discussed at some length with Congress at the time our view that people who were buying insurance in the non-group market, not through their employer but on their own, would face, on average, increase in the premiums that they paid for health insurance, primarily because the policies that they would be having to buy under the Affordable Care Act would cover a larger share of healthcare services, so that their copayments would be down, but their premiums would be up. And we made that information available to the Congress in 2009. On your second question, as you know, we've done a very lengthy analysis of how the cost of the coverage expansion under the Affordable Care Act would vary depending on different sorts of responses by employers and employees to the incentives created by the act. And we gave a great deal of thought to our analysis of those responses in our basic estimates of the Affordable Care Act, but then we did this very long analysis of what would happen in terms of sources of insurance coverage and the cost to the federal government if employees and employers behave in rather different ways than we had expected. We have not done the analysis that you requested, of what would happen if all employers were to drop employer-sponsored insurance. We don't think that is a plausible outcome. In the analysis that we did, we show what we thought would happen under a wide range of plausible possibilities.
Our amendment asked for 30, 50, and 100%. So again, I would still ask the CBO to conduct that, but then go on with your answer.
So as I said, Senator, the analysis that we did covered, we viewed as a wide range of plausible possible outcomes. On the third issue, the Affordable Care Act has a cost over the current 10-year period from the coverage provisions that we estimate to be about $1.3 or $1.4 trillion. And that money is offset in our estimate by a combination of cuts in other sorts of spending, primarily in Medicare spending, relative to prior law, and increases in tax revenue of about $1 trillion relative to prior law.
What am I looking at when I'm getting $2.4 trillion over the next 10 years?
I'm afraid I don't know, Senator. I have the table in front of me that is our May estimate of the budgetary effects of the insurance coverage provisions contained in the ACA, and the bottom line over the coming decade is $1.4 trillion. So I don't, we should talk about what numbers you're looking at, Senator.
Congresswoman Lowy.
Mr. Chairman, I ask that the record of our proceeding include the letter submitted by the Appropriation Committee Chair, Senator Mikulski, and Representative Rogers, along with a statement by each calling for sequestration to be replaced.
Without objection.
As we are all keenly aware, January 15th is the deadline for passing legislation to keep the government running. The shutdown cost our economy 120,000 jobs, billions in economic activity. This conference committee must be successful in reaching agreement on a funding level for fiscal year 2014 with enough time for bills to pass before January 15th and a funding level for fiscal year 15 so that we avoid another dysfunctional, unrealistic budget and appropriations process in just a few months, as noted in the letter from our appropriations chairs. There is also bipartisan demand for us to end the sequester. As Mr. Rogers has said, sequestration, and I quote, is unrealistic, ill-conceived, discretionary cuts must be brought to an end. As CBO has repeatedly noted, the sequester will cost our economy an estimated 800,000 more jobs in 2014 alone. So I think it bears repeating. Could you please share CBO's analysis on the overall impact of sequestration on job and economic growth for 2013, and what you think the impact will be for 2014 if sequestration remains in place?
So, Congresswoman, I think the thing that's, let me quote from a letter we wrote to Congressman Van Hollen a couple of months ago. We said that if the automatic spending reductions specified in the Budget Control Act, including both the effects on discretionary spending and the sequestration of mandatory spending, if those reductions were eliminated, that would increase real GDP by 0.6% by the fourth quarter of 2014 and would raise full-time equivalent employment by 800,000 people by the fourth quarter of 2014.
I thank you very much, Mr. Elmendorf, and I really thank you for your testimony today. This just amplifies the stakes of our conference committee's work, and I hope that our committee will really begin working in earnest toward an agreement in the coming days to prevent the economic damage that partisan politics and the sequester could cause in the coming months. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Nita. Let's go with right next to you, Congressman Cole, and then Senator Coons.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I want to assure you that my good friend and I did not coordinate our remarks, and I, too, was going to ask that letter be placed in the record, so I'm glad that my friend has already done. So please make that from both those. To have a formal statement.
The speaking order was just random.
Submit along with it. Just a couple of points and then a question. I want to quote from that letter because it does make a couple of pretty importance. We ask that the Budget Committee, under your leadership, endeavor to agree on a common overall discretionary number no later than December 2nd, preferably by November 22nd. November 22nd is 9 days away, and we don't have any scheduled meetings between the 22nd and December 2nd. So this is a matter of some urgency so that our colleagues on the Appropriations Committee, which of course includes my friend Ms. Loy and myself, have the opportunity to get about the business of arriving at real spending bills. This is both a bigger and a littler problem than what we're faced with. Mr. Elmendorf has given us a wonderful presentation on long-term debt. We don't disagree with any of that, and he's absolutely right, and we need to address it. On the other hand, the more immediate problem, the two bodies are only about $90 billion apart. And to borrow a point that was made by Senator Kaine in our last session, that's really not that big a deal in a $3.5 trillion budget. And we ought to be able to give the appropriators a number for both fiscal year 14 and I would hope fiscal year 15 as well, so that they could literally have an uninterrupted stretch of time to deal with our budget. Let me ask this question to you, Mr. Elmendorf. You are probably more familiar than anybody here with the House budget, the Senate budget, and the President's budget. I would ask you if you could, and you may not be able to do this off the top of your head, you probably can't, but can you tell us, are there enough savings in those three budgets to bridge the gap between the House and the Senate budget, which is, again, only $90 billion and over a two-year period, I think, the two chairmen have said they could probably do it with $100, $125 billion worth of spending. Again, not a lot out of almost $7 trillion.
Congressman, I think there are proposals for spending cuts in the two budgets that overlap, but I can't list them, and I don't know what their magnitude is.
Could you just prepare for us for future reference a list of those sorts of cuts so we would have the options, really, that all sides have agreed on to one degree or another in that area?
We can look into that, Congressman. As you know, budget resolutions are not analyzed by CBO directly. They're not pieces of legislation that we attach costs to.
They
are plans of the budget committees that I think they build using information from us. But I can see if we can be helpful to you in that.
I would appreciate that. Thank you very much.
I would just add that the CBO does not score budget resolutions, so they don't have those scores on the shelf. But we have all looked at each other's budgets and looked where those overlaps.
Yeah, it would just be helpful, I think, if we had that at the disposal of all the members, because I think there are enough common areas here for my friend and I to find a common figure and put the appropriators to work.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're back.
Senator Coons.
Director Elmendorf, I too am deeply concerned about what's reflected in your chart, that while short-term unemployment has come back down, long-term unemployment remains very high and is persistent and worryingly so, both in terms of the human costs and the long-term costs for our economy. You've testified before that not all cuts are the same and that there are some ways in which we are cutting that are hurting our long-term competitiveness, that short-term cuts in things like education or infrastructure or research and development produce longer-term reductions in our capacity. And that we should be prioritizing things that will accelerate growth, that we should not be simply trying to get through this difficult fiscal time in a way that focuses on austerity, that we should also be investing in a way that sustains growth. What types of policies, in your view, could both help accelerate growth and do so in a way that would deal with long-term unemployment? And what do you think are the impacts of sequestration on long-term unemployment? What are the budgetary implications of persistently high long-term unemployment?
So in the first part of your question, Senator, of all non-defense discretionary spending, about half represents investment of some sort. About 20% of non-defense discretionary spending is investment in physical capital, such as highways. Another 15% goes for education and training, and about 10% goes for R&D, such as health research. Overall, we think those investments help to build a stronger economy in the future, and cutbacks in those investments would reduce output and income in the future. But I think it's also important to say that different pieces of those elements of spending may be much more or much less effective than others in terms of their long-term growth. And we've done some work in this area, but it's very difficult to draw broad conclusions. And I would note from a study we rewrote a few years ago, we said that This was about research, and we wrote federal spending in support of basic research has, on average, had a significantly positive return. We also noted that gross generalization is difficult to apply as guidance for decisions across budget functions, agencies' budgets, and appropriation subcommittee jurisdictions. So there are some broad lessons, I think, and then there are some evidence that we and others have generated for particular sorts of federal investments, but it's nothing like a comprehensive evaluation of where in that large non-defense pool the money should be devoted. On the question of long-term unemployment, this is very damaging, obviously for the people involved, many of whom have very little source of support for an extended period of time. Whatever savings people may have to get through a short unemployment spell is much more likely to be exhausted if one is unemployed for half a year or a year or longer. But also has, beyond the personal effects, important economic effects over time. Some people who are unemployed for a long time simply give up looking for work. Some people probably find their way into disability insurance. The applications for the disability part of the Social Security program have gone up quite rapidly over the past few years. And people who go into that program very rarely come back out of it into the labor force. And even people who keep looking for work have skills that are depreciating over time. Technical skills, but also connections to the workforce, connections to people who are working. So it poses a very large risk of there being some set of people who will not find their way back to work at all, or will not find their way back to the productive sort of work that they were in before they lost their jobs.
Are there investments in skills training and in the manufacturing sector in particular that strike you because of that combination of factors as having the highest potential for contributing to our competitiveness and getting people back to work who have been unemployed for long periods of time?
I don't have a simple answer to that. In this report that I mentioned to Senator Baldwin, we reviewed the evidence on a large number of different ways of trying to help people get back into the labor force. And as I said, I think the general lesson is that a number of those programs have been successful on a small scale, but have not been tried on a large scale. Others have not even been quite so successful on a small scale. It's a hard thing to do, and I don't want to discourage people from doing it, but I don't have a short, crisp answer. But would be happy, as I said, to sit down with you and talk about the elements in that report and help you construct policy in that area if you'd like.
Thank you. Next we'll go with Senator Grassley and then Senator Nelson.
We've heard voices this morning about sequestration being bad, something that was adopted in a bipartisan, bicameral, and with White House support, a suggestion coming from the White House. I don't know how we could hear that, particularly since sequestration is working. We've heard arguments for raising taxes. You can't raise taxes high enough to satisfy the appetite of Washington to spend money. Closing loopholes are very legitimate. The tax code is a mess. But closing tax loopholes to spend more is not going to have long-range good results, because you get the higher level of expenditure and you keep it there. Closing loopholes for tax reform is what's needed, and I support that. I'd like to give a caution to rumors that we hear about sequestration, that there will be compromise on sequestration so we can spend more on defense. And since the economy is so bad, and since jobs are what's on everybody's mind, what we ought to be working on, I hope we keep in mind that economic strength of our nation is a necessary precondition to our military strength. Without economic strength, there won't be any national security. Compromising on sequester for more money for the military, I think, is short-sighted, and hopefully those suggestions that you hear primarily out of the House of Representatives won't be pursued. And if they are pursued, I think it's short-sighted from the standpoint of the cooperation that you have to have on Hill between people of the same political party. It's kind of like feeding Senate Republicans to the wolves. So I hope you remember to keep our eye on the ball. The ball is the economy and jobs, strengthening our economy so we can be the sleeping giant that Admiral Yamamoto warned the Japanese warlords about. Don't attack the United States. We got to have a strong economy in order to have a strong defense. I yield.
Senator Nelson's not here. Let's go with Senator Ayotte, then Senator Warner.
Thank you, Dr. Elmendorf. I have actually two questions. First of all, a question. As I understand, under the Affordable Care Act, there's a three-year assumption of 100% pay for the state share of the Medicaid expansion. I wondered if that assumption carried out throughout your budget outlook, or your assumption assumes that that share will be reduced, number one. And secondly, as I look at your budget outlook, where I see the real significant issues in terms of getting our fiscal house in order, and also I think of deep concern to our seniors, the trustees have said Medicare goes bankrupt in 2026, Social Security 2033, the disability fund you referenced 2016. And is there a way for us to address our long-term fiscal outlook if we don't reform those programs? Or also, are we able to even sustain them for the beneficiaries that will rely on them?
So, Senator, on your first question, our baseline projections follow current law in which the federal share of Medicaid costs for the additional populations under the Affordable Care Act declines from 100% to 90% over a few years later in this coming decade. And our projections incorporate that and that feature of current law, like other features of current law.
So just to be clear, if after 3 years the states come to us and say, we want you to continue to pay 100%, that is not accounted for in this fiscal outlook.
That's right, Senator. We would provide a cost estimate for that legislation if it came to us, and it would show additional costs for the federal government.
And with regard to obviously important programs, I think, to all of us, but also a big challenge we face?
Yes. On your second question, as my charts showed, the rise in spending for Social Security and Medicare under current law, relative to the size of the economy, is quite large. And that will require one of three possible, or a combination of three possible courses of action. You and your colleagues could cut back on spending for those programs. You could raise revenues above their historical share of GDP, or you could cut all other federal programs, the combination of all other federal programs, below the benefits and services that we've become accustomed to. It's not an analytic matter to say which of those is better or worse, but the analytic point is that you don't have a choice about doing at least one of those things, and you can do one or two or three of them if you choose to, but at least one of those things will have to change.
But you've also pointed out we're going to be at a historical high for revenues at that point as well, so that's a challenge for us because at some point it is a negative impact on economic growth.
So revenues will be a historically high share of GDP. All federal spending apart from spending for this handful of large programs will be at a historically low share of GDP, but those movements, as they're written, as we think they will play out under current law, are not enough together to support the extra costs for Social Security and Medicare relative to their history. And that's why more has to be done.
Thank you.
Senator Warner, then we'll go with Congresswoman Black, then Senator Stabenow.
Thank you, Chairman Ryan. Let me first of all say, as someone who has been naive enough to believe that we could actually do a larger deal, for some time, I, at this moment in time, at least want to say to you and Chairman Murray that at least getting something done for a year or two would, I think, have an extraordinarily positive effect upon the marketplace and upon economic growth. And replacing some of the worst of sequestration, I think, is a worthy goal, being kind of Virginia being ground zero. I guess I've got for the chairman four quick questions, and recognizing we've got time constraints. I agree with Senator Portman that the potential rise in interest rates is a factor that we have not fully computed in. And I wondered whether, let me get all these out so I'll get within time. You know, I believe we are now imposing upon the economy a debt ceiling tax, that you'll see a spike in interest rates every time you see a debt ceiling date come about. I'd be curious to know whether the CBO has done any estimate of what kind of cost that bear. We have another one of those debt ceiling taxes coming around December or February 7th. Second, infrastructure in America, I think we all agree, it's recent ranking, it's got a D grade. Delayed maintenance of our infrastructure, delayed construction is a tax because at some point it will have to be replaced. And I'd love to know whether there's been any analysis made on that subject. Third, and I know Senator Portman and I have had gone around and around on this, and Senator Yacht just raise this about percent of revenues. I would simply point out One of the reasons why we have a $17 trillion debt is that based upon historic revenue numbers, we've always been in an annual deficit. The only times we've had a surplus within the last 30 years have been when revenues have been between 19.5% and 21%. So anything at that lower rates, you know, will continue to have, will be in deficit. And I would simply say, even with entitlement reform, and I strongly believe in entitlement reform, I guess I question on a going forward basis, and I even look at your numbers with revenues at a higher rate that's still below 19, we're still in that gap. Two questions. One, because of the demographic bulge and longevity of life, even with entitlement reform, it's hard to imagine how you're going to be able to drive the spend down to the numbers that could be dealt with on any kind of historic revenue basis. And last point, it seems to me that one thing that we may not have factored in, and I don't know if you've done any analysis, is that not just in America but across the world, we've seen a dramatic shift from the private sector to the public sector in both the areas of workforce training and particularly the area of research and development. There is no longer a Bell Lab, and more corporate America and corporations around the world are expecting the public sector to pick up the R&D costs. Can you speak to that as well?
Yes. On your first point about interest rates, I should say we think we do have it fully in our projection. You suggested that maybe it had not been fully taken on board. In our numbers, we think it is fully taken on board. We have built in a substantial increase, a normalization in interest rates to a level that is consistent with the historical experience, but a little higher because there'll be more federal debt relative to GDP under current law. So on the question about the debt ceiling, I think that the fears of default have been a negative factor for the economy, but we have not tried to quantify that. On your point about infrastructure, we've done some work, particularly on highways, drawing on the work of the Federal Highway Administration. This says that in order to maintain the current functionality of highways, more would need to be spent than is being spent under current law. And using building off of cost-benefit analysis that the Federal Highway Administration did, that the amount of spending on highways for which the benefits would exceed the costs would be much higher than the amount under current law. You asked the question about entitlement reform, and given longevity, the difficulty, whatever reforms were made to Social Security and Medicare, of keeping costs for those programs back where they used to be. And I think you're right, Senator. On average, over the past 40 years, Social Security and Medicare represented outlays for those programs were 6% of GDP. By 2038, under current law, we think outlays for those programs will be about 11% of GDP. So the cut in spending that would be required on those programs, that would be required to bring them back to the historical average, would be a cut of almost one half. We have a lot of options in our book of options. We don't have anything that would accomplish that. I think there is, and as I said to start with, there's no particular reason why those programs should go back to their historical share of GDP, given that many more people, a much larger share of the population, would be eligible for them. On the other hand, if one does not restrain those programs, then significant changes need to be made, either in cutting other benefits and services that we are used to, or in raising taxes above what we have paid in the past. Is there anything else you'd like, Senator? Did I miss? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So on R&D, we are in the process of producing a chart book of federal investments and some of the private sector investments as well. I think in terms of development, there's often a great deal, and there's been a growth in private sector development, but in the more basic forms of research, that is the sort of output for the economy that the private sector will tend not to do enough of because the benefits are so dispersed across the economy. And a very widespread view among economists that is really a responsibility for the federal government to support that sort of basic research.
Thank you. Ms. Black's not here, so we'll go with Ms. Stabenow, and I'll just run through the list so those of you who know. Stabenow, Graham, Merkley, Kane, Wyden. So Ms. Stabenow.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Elmendorf. In listening to you, it really is striking to me we have a short-term challenge that's different than long-term in some ways. And the good news is we've actually begun to tackle long-term $2.5 trillion of the $4 trillion we've all talked about already being put in place, the yearly deficit coming down by half. Good news. The challenge, though, is in the short run, as you talk about growing the economy and being smart, not reckless, in what we're doing. And when we look at that, it seems to me a good way of summing up is to say we're not going to get out of debt with more than 11 million people out of work. And so we've, a number of us, been talking about the economy. And I'm wondering if you might just talk a little bit more in terms of the short term, how we're smart about growing the economy. The National Association of Manufacturers Manufacturing Institute says there are about 600,000 manufacturing jobs unfilled right now because skills are different than the jobs available. And the National Skill Coalition says about 300,000 people are going to be turned away from training programs because of the sequester cut. So we've got inability, if we continue down this road, to provide training, whether it's the 20 to 25-year-old that you talked about where we have a 12.5% unemployment or others. I mean, if we don't do this right, if we don't stop what is, in my judgment, recklessness in terms of how we approach cutting spending, we are cutting off our nose to spite our face in terms of economic growth. The other, and Senator Warner talked about, is on innovation. Since 2011, countries like China and India have increased their investment in basic research. We're cutting ours. Again, short term, not looking very wisely at what happens in terms of across the board cuts on sequester, on education innovation, which seem to me are critical if we're going to grow the economy and get people back to work. Could you talk a little bit more about that in terms of what we need to do, skills gap, so on?
Senator, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the sharp reduction in the deficit over the past few years has had the beneficial effect of reducing the accumulation of government debt, but it has had the adverse effect of slowing the economic recovery. That's a trade-off that's up to you and your colleagues to make, and I think we've been clear now for a number of years about the trade-off that you face in that regard. I think the skills gap is partly an issue in the short term and even more important in some ways over the longer term. An important source of growth in the American economy, growth in people's incomes, has been the greater education that people have received, both in a sort of formal education sense, but also in terms of training that people get. And if that doesn't continue to happen, then that will have adverse consequences on our future ability to consume, our ability to raise our standard of living over time in the way that we have in the past. I think one, and there's a set of programs that the government supports, mostly at least through non-defense discretionary spending of one sort or another, that can help to build people's skills, can help to do the research that's needed, that private research and development efforts can then build on. And I think as you discuss the amount and composition of non-defense discretionary funding, I think it would be very appropriate for you and your colleagues to be concerned about what the effects would be over time of those different sorts of investments. And we're happy to talk with you about the work that we've done or know of that other people have done. As I said, I think there aren't simple lessons about in all the there isn't that much empirical evidence about just how much how certain things work better than others, but whatever there is, we're happy to try to bring to your attention.
Mr. Chairman, just as a note, I don't know if other colleagues are finding this, but the number one issue I'm hearing now from manufacturers and other businesses really does relate to this issue of skills gap, and so I hope we'll keep that in mind.
I heard it at InSinkErator in Racine on Monday.
Did you? Yeah.
Yep. Mr. Graham.
Cut it off. Thanks. Mr. Elmendorf, let's talk about general treasury obligations regarding entitlements. Medicare. What percentage of Medicare payments come from the general treasury?
Senator, in our long-term budget outlook, we reported, we showed that in a figure.
Well, let's just make it really of you know, $3 out of $4, $2 out of $3.
So, Senator, in about now, roughly roughly half of total Medicare outlays come out of general revenues. The other half come largely out of Medicare payroll taxes and some out of offsetting receipts, which are principally premium.
What percentage
payments
comes from the patient population?
So premiums, Senator, are, I think, about 10% of Medicare payments.
Over time, this problem really becomes difficult for the general treasury, right? Medicare obligations over time grow.
Yes, very much, Senator.
Well, because 10,000 people a day and the baby boomers are retiring, right?
Yes.
There are about 80 million of us in the next 40 years, 80 million people are going to go into retirement. When I was born in 1955, there were 16 workers for every retiree. Today, how many are there?
A few, Senator.
Three. Okay. In 20 years, how many will it be?
Two.
Two, right. So here's the big dilemma. If 80 million people are going to retire, and the demographics have changed from 16 workers for every retiree when I was born until three now in 20 years, two, we got a problem. You agree with that?
Yes, Senator.
Okay. So when it comes to general treasury obligations in the future, I just don't see how we can avoid entitlement reform. Do you agree with that? Either raise taxes a lot or cut benefits a lot, one of the two.
Well, I think the third possibility, Senator, is to cut even further than is scheduled under current law into the other benefits and services that the government provides. And as we've noted, as you understand,
right,
under current law, that other spending will already amount to a smaller share of GDP than it has in many decades. But I just want to say logically that's your other alternative.
Not to take too much time. We've got a problem that can't be ignored, and that's the retirement of the baby boomers. Is that correct?
That's correct, Senator.
Is that why President Obama decided to address CPI reform as well as means testing of Medicare benefits?
Senator, as you know, I will not speak to the president's motivations. I can add one thing.
Why don't you go talk to him and ask him?
I think not, Senator.
I mean, did he just wake up one day and say, I want to change CPI and means test benefits for no good reason?
I would just note along the lines of your question, Senator, in our long-term budget outlook, we did an analysis of the sources of growth in spending for social security.
Would you agree with me that it would be responsible for a president of the United States, Democrat or Republican, to be thinking about CBI reform and means testing Medicare benefits?
Senator, I will not comment on what the president should do.
I know Senator Graham came late, but we were talking about 2 minutes for questions.
All right.
May I just note for your and other people's interest, Senator, in our long-term budget outlook, we did an analysis of the sources of growth in spending for Social Security and Medicare as a share of GDP over the next 25 years.
Okay.
And fully half of the growth in spending for those two programs as a share of GDP is just from the aging of the population and the rising number of beneficiaries.
Last question. Can you tell me how two people...
What are you, last question? Gee, good Lord. Sorry.
Last question.
This is why Senator's
I gotta go.
Late, isn't it?
Yeah. Tell me how two people can do what 16 people used to do.
That would require a lot of productivity growth, Senator.
Senator Merkley.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Elmendorf, and, for this discussion. I want to reinforce Senator Sanders' point that in thinking about the budget, we should understand the current state of affairs in America. And certainly the current state of affairs is that a very large proportion of the income is going to very few. Very large percentage of the wealth is held by very few. But another key point is that we are losing living wage jobs. By one estimate, 60% of the jobs that we lost in the Great Recession were living wage jobs, and less than 40% of the ones that are recovering are living wage jobs. Is that a piece of the puzzle that you have insight on?
Well, so Senator, I can't speak to those precise numbers offhand, but you're certainly correct that over a number of decades now, a larger share of total income has gone to people at the very top of the income distribution, and that many people elsewhere in the income distribution have experienced a very little increase in their standard of living.
Well, the reason I want to emphasize this living wage jobs is that when folks have living wage jobs, they don't need other programs, and it reduces the government expenditures considerably. So as we were restructuring our economy by not investing in the areas that create living wage jobs, we're increasing the burden, if you will, that's borne by the safety net. In that regard, I just wanted to reinforce this point over investing for growth. We've had some comments around the table that if you are spending money on a tax loophole or a credit or deduction, and you close that loophole, you should not consider spending that money on something that would create growth. And example here is we've had a very good example on the manufacturing side of investing for training that will enable people to fill manufacturing jobs, which are largely living wage jobs. We have tax loopholes that basically compensate companies and reward them for shipping jobs overseas. Is there any possible way that that can be construed as something that really helps our country grow our economy here at home or increase the number of living wage jobs?
Senator, I don't want to speculate offhand about the features of particular provisions of the corporate tax code, which you know is a very complicated business. But as I suggested earlier in response to questions, reform of the corporate tax code and reform of the individual tax code could have a significant positive effect on the overall U.S. economy and on particular people in that economy, depending on how that tax reform is
constructed. You're being very diplomatic, but I think most of us understand that if you spend money to eliminate jobs in America and put them somewhere else in the world, that hurts our own economy here at home, while investing in training to create jobs here improves our economy.
Yes, Senator, but there's a growing and complicated empirical literature by economists about how the how helping U.S. companies compete overseas can either hurt or help their activities in this country. And that's the issue I don't want to wade into off the cuff while I sit here.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Kane.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dr. Elmendorf, I want to ask you a question about what I thought was the end of your oral presentation. We don't have the written testimony, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it seemed at the end of your oral presentation, after you were done with the charts, you were sort of offering the sort of hortatory advice to us about the salutary effects of finding a deal, that it would have some, just the mere fact of finding a deal, and which would involve compromise between the House and the Senate, would have some positives on the economy. This refers a little bit to the opening comment that Senator Warner made. I've been worried about sort of uncertainty as an ankle weight around economic recovery, and I would just like to have you elaborate upon those final comments and talk about the extent to which you think uncertainty has been an ankle weight on the recovery, and if we could find a deal for 14, 15, or maybe even set some parameters for beyond, we would likely see positive economic effects.
Yes, Senator. So we and many analysts, I think, have concluded that uncertainty about federal fiscal policy has been a considerable drag on economic activity in the past few years. But quantifying that effect is very, very difficult. And we've had some people speak at our panel of economic advisors, in fact, who have done work in that area to see how far we could go. And I think the conclusion of the room of our advisors was that the results were qualitatively very suggestive, but there was no way to quantify that effect. That's why we don't turn up with numbers. But lots of things are important that can't be quantified. And again, in our judgment to many other people's, the uncertainty about what will happen to taxes, federal taxes and federal spending has been an important source, an important headwind to the economic recovery. And my remarks concluded by noting that a broad solution to the long-term budget challenge would, of course, be salutary, but that even if that is not feasible now, reallocating portions of the budget in ways that fit what you think would be best for the country and would reduce uncertainty about what fiscal policy will do over the next year or two or three, while improving or at least not worsening the long-term budget outlook, would be a positive factor for the economy now and next year and the year after. And I think there are very few large problems that are settled in one go. I don't want to discourage ambition on the part of the committee, but I think one should, in many lines of life, the perfect should not be the enemy of the good. And I think that applies to budget policy as well.
Thank you. Is Ron here? Yeah. Mr. Wyden.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Director Elmendorf, I think we know traditionally when you're trying to find a consensus for a conference like this, you look to both sides in areas where they're on record as supporting changes. For example, Chairman Camp in the House and the President's Treasury Department have identified among the $1 trillion of tax expenditures that the tax treatment of derivatives is particularly inefficient and abusive. Now, you can't be in the business of advocating specific policies this morning, and we all get that. So let me just put this as a theory. Is it correct to say that theoretically, you could eliminate several of the most flagrant tax loopholes without compromising the broader tax reform agenda, just in theory?
Yes, Senator, that sounds right to me.
Okay. Thank you for that. And the only other thing I wanted to do, Chairman Ryan, is to ask that we put into the record at this point a chart that Director Elmendorf sent to you a few weeks ago. I thought it was particularly important because the chart demonstrates that for 2014, Congress adhered to the caps for non-defense discretionary spending, but chose to disregard the caps for defense. And I would just ask unanimous consent that we put that chart into the record at this point.
Without objection.
Thank you, and I thank the director.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you.
Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a real sense of urgency about this for one of the reasons that's been mentioned several times, and that's uncertainty. There's no question that the uncertainty of the policy here in Washington is affecting the economy. It's also undermining confidence generally in the country and undermining certainly confidence in this institution. To that end, I have a modest proposal I commend to you as a suggested way to begin to talk about a result for this conference. I call it the Grande proposal. They tell me in Starbucks speak, Grande is in the middle. It's a medium size.
I just call it medium.
It's a medium, okay. Here's what I'm proposing, a 10-year deal, which would include mandatory cuts, cuts in mandatory spending, revenues, and a smoothing to substantially mitigate the effects of the sequester, but produce the same deficit reduction effect. Number one, cut the sequester caps in half through a combination of cuts in mandatory spending of $255 billion and revenues derived from reducing corporate tax expenditures of $200 billion. You would generate an additional $325 billion in additional revenue from corporate tax reform, which would be applied to corporate rate reduction, and an infrastructure fund in the ratio of 5-1. $275 billion rate reduction, $50 billion infrastructure fund, which would take the current corporate rate from 35% to 32.5%. You're left with half the sequester amounts, and you would apply the smoothing concept that Senator Sessions has suggested in terms of the interest, the growth rate, which would essentially minimize.
Do you mean smoothing on pensions?
This is smoothing the rate of growth in the sequestered amounts. As you know, there are varying growth rates, and if you lower the rates in the out years, increase them in the near years, you can in effect eliminate the cuts that we're now facing. This would provide certainty to the appropriators. We'd give them numbers that they could then work with, and that in turn gives us the flexibility that many people have talked about in the appropriations process here in the Congress rather than in the administration. I think there's something in there for everyone to dislike, but I hope that you will take a look at it and consider this as a possible, and it leaves further deficit reduction for further talks, but it solves the immediate problem of the sequester. And yet, we end up at exactly the same place in terms of deficit reduction as under current law. So that's the proposal that I commend to you for your consideration.
And as mentioned before, I encourage every one of our colleagues, if they have suggestions, please submit them. But thank you. Thank you. Mr. Van Hollen.
Oh, thank you.
Then Ron.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Dr. Elmendorf. I just want to get back to a point that was raised by Senator Portman and Senator Warner with respect to historic revenues as a percent of GDP. You pointed out that from 1973 to 2012, it was 17.4% revenues percent of GDP. Of course, we were running deficits at 3% on average, and as Senator Warner pointed out, the only time in that entire period we did not run deficits was 1998 to 2001, where the revenues as a percent of GDP averaged about 19.5%. If you look at your chart under current policy, at the end of this 10-year window, we would still be at least a percentage point approximately of revenue of GDP below what it was when we balanced the budget. And I would point out, between now and then, we will have a 33% increase in Medicare beneficiaries and a 30% increase in Social Security beneficiaries. So huge increase in seniors that qualify or are eligible for Social Security and Medicare at a lower revenue as a percent of GDP then, 10 years from now, than we had in the years that we actually balanced a budget. So I wanted to emphasize that point, because it seems to me it's hard to say you care about reducing our long-term deficit, but have a position that you won't close a single tax break or loophole or eliminate any tax expenditures for the purpose of reducing the deficit. Senator Crapo pointed out, in response to your pointing out, that the recovery helped cushion the economy during a really difficult time, that some of the debt service in the out years will provide a little bit of drag. I would just point out that the drag from the interest rates we're incurring as a result of the wars, the unpaid-for prescription drug plan, and the tax rates dwarf any out-year drag from the recovery bill. The sequester, as you pointed out, now will result in approximately 800,000 fewer jobs by this time next year. We should fix that. My question, Mr. Elmendorf, deals with unemployment compensation. At the end of this year, the current policy on unemployment compensation will expire. Could you tell us what impact that will have on economic growth? These are people who are still looking for work, out of work through no fault of their own. What benefit would it be to the economy from extending that current policy on unemployment compensation?
So, Congressman, we wrote in a report about this time last year that extending the additional unemployment insurance benefits through 2013 would provide a boost to GDP and to jobs in 2013. We think that extending the benefits now through the end of 2014 would provide a boost to GDP and a boost to jobs next year, but we have not yet tried to quantify that. You may be about to ask.
Just, Mr. Chairman, if I would ask CBO if you could quantify that impact. Mike.
We'll look into that, Congressman.
Let's go Senator Johnson, then Senator Sessions, then Senator Murray, I think, and then that.
Director Elmendorf, we're giving you a sheet of paper on the cost of Obamacare. Quick couple of rapid-fire questions on Social Security. The trust fund holds about $2.6 trillion of non-marketable government bonds, correct?
That sounds about right, Senator.
Okay. And then the Treasury has a $2.6 trillion liability, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so if you consolidate the books of the federal government, the asset offsets liability and it has a net monetary value of zero, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, so the trust fund really to the federal government has no monetary value in total, consolidated basis.
And in fact, Senator, we work, as you know, on a consolidated basis. That's why we talk about the federal debt held by the public, and we talk about the prospective revenue
but again,
and spending
to
for the entire
federal
government.
The federal government is an entity. It has zero monetary value. Now I want to quick go back to my cost of Obamacare. In front of you now is what I was looking at that showed over the next 10 years the cost of the Affordable Care Act would be about $2.4 trillion. I'm not sure what you were categorizing as about 1.3, but I mean, do you basically agree with this analysis, discretionary spending? I won't go through it, but.
So let me clarify what I was saying. I was referring to the cost of the coverage provisions.
Okay, I'm
of the
talking
Affordable
about
Care
all,
Act.
All the expenses that the Affordable Care Act is going to cost the federal government over the next 10 years, about $2.4 trillion, correct?
So we have not tried to tote up the costs in this way, Senator. I can check. We have I have here our estimate of the effects of repealing the legislation that we provided to Speaker of the House last summer that has a breakdown of total outlays and receipts. And if I can find it. So by our estimates, from last summer, the total cost, the total addition in outlays over the coming decade was about $900 billion, and the total increase in revenues was about $1 trillion from the Affordable Care Act. But you are doing, I think, a different sort of breakdown to construct the pieces you have here, and I just, we can look at it and but I can't.
Yeah, I definitely, because like, we're showing about $2.4 trillion, about $1 trillion in revenue. So my question is, where does the $1.4 trillion come from to make up that gap? So we'll talk to you offline.
So as I said generally before, Senator, there are cuts in other sorts of spending and increases in revenues. And that's why, on balance, taking all of the provisions of the Affordable Care Act together, we estimated that it would reduce deficits and that repealing it would increase deficits.
In the current budget window, you're still sticking to that?
Yes.
In the current budget window. Okay.
Yes, Senator.
Thank you. Senator Sessions.
Thank you. With regard to the sequester and the job short term, but in the long term, your report makes clear on chart 6.2, as we discussed earlier, that if we don't adhere to that $2 trillion in savings, we'll see a minus 7% reduction in long-run GDP, whereas if we do, we would have a 4% gain, which is a huge difference, and if we would take another $2 billion out, we'd have a 7% gain. So the long term, I think we just all have to realize that sometimes you have to take some medicine to get off an illness. Are you familiar, Dr. Elmendorf, with a new IMF, International Monetary Fund, report on Europe that found on all the actions they've been taking over there that tax increases are 2 to 5 times more harmful as cutting spending to reduce deficits?
I've heard of the report, Senator. I've not read the details of it. And I should say, as you know, in our analysis of the effects of changes in the budget, we try to incorporate the effects of changes in tax rates in addition to the effects of changes in overall amount of government borrowing.
And your findings are not inconsistent with that general principle. I mean, your findings would indicate also that tax increases are less helpful than spending cuts over the long term to deal with deficits.
So the one clarification I would offer, Senator, is that increases in marginal tax rates, the tax rate people pay on an additional hour of work or additional dollar of saving, increases in marginal tax rates slow the economy relative to some other way of reducing the deficit that does not affect people's behavior.
With regard then to marginal rates, you would agree that tax increases are less advantageous over the long run for the economy than spending cuts.
Than spending cuts that do not otherwise distort people's behavior. Again, we come back to some of the discussion about the role of investment. Federal investments can also help the economy in the long run. So I want to be very careful here. An increase in tax rate,
well,
but Senator, the point is this.
That's
the point
not
is,
what your report says. Basically,
no, actually,
your report
Senator,
says that in general, that the tax increases are less helpful in reducing the deficit as our tax increases do more damage to growth over time than spending reductions as we seek to reduce deficits.
So, Senator, I think we try to be very careful in our reports not to paint either all tax increases or all spending cuts with the same broad brush.
Well, I know.
And I think, as you understand, the incentive effects
I'm
of
gonna look at your
behavior
report.
Are important.
I think it says kind of what I said.
Rate increases.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
You. We'll go to Mr. Whitehouse.
Thank you, Chairman. Dr. Elmendorf, one of the issues that we have to address is the cost of health care in the federal budget. As you and I have discussed before, the cost of health care in the federal budget relates to the cost of health care in the country. And the figures I have is that we are spending about 18% of our GDP on health care nationally, and that figure is northbound, headed for 20 and higher.
Yes, Senator.
And that the least efficient of our competitor industrialized nations is burning maybe 12% of their economy on health care. So we pay about a 50% inefficiency premium in our health care system compared to other industrialized countries. The President's Council of Economic Advisors said that there's $700 billion per year to be saved in the healthcare system without affecting the quality of care in any adverse way. The Institutes of Medicine, I think, are at $750 billion. RAND came out with a range, and I think the midpoint of RAND Corporation's range was around $780 billion. Lewin Group and George Bush's Treasury Secretary, who's pretty knowledgeable on this because he ran the Pittsburgh group that focused on health care, they're at $1 trillion a year. So these are some very, 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 very big numbers, and 40%+ of those numbers would come back into the federal budget if we were able to achieve those savings on a national level. So I know that there's a scoring problem with trying to work from the national health care cost savings into the federal budget. But just in terms of talking to us as members of Congress, in terms of the priorities that you see out there, how important is it for us to get a handle on the health care cost problem in the United States?
So, Senator, I think it is can make a tremendous difference for the federal budget if you and your colleagues and the people running federal health care programs can find ways to slow the growth of costs that do not adversely affect people's health. But I think the principal problem there is not a scoring.
That's the premise of all the different studies that I've reported, is that it won't hurt people's health care. It'll actually probably improve it.
I understand, Senator. But I would the place I would disagree with you is that I think it's not basically a scoring problem as a policy problem that you confront. So there's very widespread agreement, as you know, among analysts and practitioners, healthcare providers, that a good deal of healthcare spending in this country is doing little or nothing to improve people's health. But there's much less agreement and much less evidence to show how federal policies should be changed to squeeze out that extra spending.
No, I'm not saying we understand the policy judgments yet, but as an area of focus, you think we should be relentless on this?
Yes, absolutely, Senator.
Thank you.
Make a huge difference.
Thank you. Before I turn for the last word to Senator Murray, I think, Mr. Clyburn, you had a UC request?
Yes, sir. Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like unanimous consent to enter into the record the Wall Street Journal article that I referenced in my comments.
All right, without objection.
Thank you.
I think he's good. Good?
Just very briefly, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you and Senator Murray for allowing us to have this dialogue and also for saving probably tens of thousands of dollars in your own budget-cutting techniques by turning off the heat in this room today.
I think it's like Wisconsin
right direction
right now in here, yeah.
Jimmy Carter had his cardigan. All we have are these suits. And just very briefly, I think this has been a great hearing. And Mr. Elmendorf, Director Elmendorf, I think, you know, what I take from what you're saying and the charts and so on is consistent with where I think there is kind of a growing consensus, which is that the two-thirds of the budget that we don't appropriate every year, which is on autopilot, which is growing to 76% of the budget based on your statistics, is where we ought to be focused a lot of our attention, even in this group. And what you said earlier was you don't mean to be too pessimistic in the sense that you think even if we made small steps in the right direction in terms of mandatory savings and reforms, that markets would respond favorably and that we would be viewed by the American people as dealing with the real problem. Is that correct? And if so, maybe it's a good conclusory statement for you to make about what you view this group.
No,
we don't. You know, we don't have all the answers here, and we don't have all the committees of jurisdiction, but we have an opportunity to do something that moves us in the right direction. What would you recommend that we do?
Well, Senator, I cannot make specific recommendations. I think that, but I would say I think the big steps are better than small steps, but small steps are better than no steps at all. And no steps at all would be better than stepping backward. So I think that the specific changes that you would make are, of course, up to you and your colleagues to judge on behalf of me and other citizens. But I think that while keeping your eye on the longer-term problems is critically important, that one should not view this as sort of the World Series or bust, that if one can move the ball a little bit, if one can make some changes that would fit your sense of what the country's priorities ought to be and would reduce uncertainty about what will happen in January and February and throughout next year, that can be an important lift to the economy, can improve the efficiency with which the federal government operates. And so I think that, as I said earlier, one should not make the perfect the enemy of the good.
Thank you. I'll give for the last word, Senator Murray.
Well, actually, Senator Portman, that was where I wanted to end as well, and echo what Senator Kaine said, is that we all appreciate your comments about not discouraging us from doing the large. Obviously, we have to keep our eye on the ball in the long run. All of us need to continue to work on that. But I think your comments today are especially important for all of us to hear, that the uncertainty that is created by the way that things have been managed by crisis and by the sequester is harmful to the economy, and that by making some small steps now, moving us forward, providing that certainty so that businesses can sign contracts and know where they're going for the next year to 2 years is extremely important for us to at least make those steps. And I appreciate your comments on that and the advice to this committee.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody for attending today's meeting. We have had a good discussion. Senator Murray and I will continue talking and consulting about how to proceed on the next steps. For now, this meeting stands adjourned.